Welcome everyone to a very exciting episode of What's Up Mainframe. If you've been a follower of the podcast for some time, you know that last year we did some episodes in front of a live kitchen audience. And indeed, we're doing that again today as part of the Mainframe Technical Exchange, an event that Broadcom puts on twice a year, once in Prague here in Europe, in Czech Republic, and another near Dallas in Texas in the US. I'm excited to have Scott Broad with us today. We met a little over 2 years ago.
Yeah, right around there.
2 years ago is when Hostbridge Technologies was actually acquired by Broadcom, and that's what we're gonna kind of dive into. But before we go there, Scott, tell us a little bit about yourself.
So my name is Scott Broad, as Zach just said. I've been with Broadcom for about 5.5 years. I came over from the customer side for a little over a decade. And then before that, I started in mainframe, I'd say about 22 years ago, which is like a middle-aged mainframer, right?
Yeah, okay.
I think that's right, right? Yeah.
Sounds good.
I travel a lot. I've got two awesome kids. and a fun fact that no one knows is I'm a magician.
We don't ever script What's Up Mainframe, but now I regret not knowing that Scott was a magician. Anyway, there might be an addendum to this episode where we see some magic, but let's... So you're product manager for the Hostbridge components, but mainly HB.js.
Yep.
And tell us generally what HB.js does.
Sure. On an aerial view, HB.js, the JS is JavaScript. Okay. So it's the Hostbridge JavaScript engine. And what it does is it runs within CICS or CICS, and it sits in a region and it allows you to create APIs for anything within CICS and orchestrating any business process. So you have all the business logic, creating an API to enable any front end or middleware developers to access anything on the mainframe without having to know anything about the mainframe.
That sounds like magic. Now, first of all, the very first part, you really distinguished yourself as a middle-aged mainframer in saying both CICS and CICS.
Yep.
And so this really is amazing in the sense of providing an understanding of what's going on with those CICS transactions applications. What is it? Transaction application? Sure. What's the...
So CICS transaction gateway, it's a product that runs on the mainframe. It's the largest transactional powerhouse on mainframe. And when I say transactional powerhouse, mainframes are transactional, but they can handle anywhere from 1,000 transactions a minute to millions of transactions a minute without blinking an eye.
Yes.
So CICS, or CICS, is where the magic happens. So you have your transaction, all your applications, programs, data, all within CICS. And we're not just talking the old kind of green screen applications, but there's lots of other programs that are within CICS, and these handle millions and millions of transactions on largest organizations every day.
And so when you're talking about these APIs, the value that it brings are to kind of several groups of people.
Mm-hmm.
There are those that don't really know or care what's happening on the mainframe side. They're more the front end folks that need to process information that's handled in those transactions.
Right.
Okay.
So your front end developers. So let's say you have an effort to modernize your platform. Right now, there's a lot of industries out there that still use a text-based CICS transaction to do a lot of their work, whether it's a point of sale system, airline travel industries, insurance companies. What HB.js does is allows a front end developer, let's say a web developer or a mobile phone developer, to integrate into those mainframe business processes, which are the crown jewels of your organization. I mean, they run the business. So it allows a front-end developer to access all those processes on mainframe without having to learn or know what the mainframe is.
And in that access, so the important thing from the mainframe side is we're not talking about additional traffic from their requests,
correct.
Right?
So a lot of times, HB.js, its bread and butter really is orchestration. You want to orchestrate everything on the platform. You want to separate your business logic and your presentation logic. So instead of having to do, let's say, microservices, I'm sure everyone's heard of microservice Yes. APIs, which was great 15, 20 years ago when it was the only thing. So instead of having to use, let's say, an RPA, robotic process automation off the mainframe, to do one business process, which might take 1,000 transactions, database calls, and it has to hit the mainframe 1,000 times.
Bad.
It's very, very bad. Network traffic is terrible. That's why bandwidth is such a big thing. So if you're able to condense that into one REST API call and all the magic happens within the JavaScript engine, it makes it so much easier. You're saving 99% network traffic, which saves CPU, which saves cost.
Just across the board. No, that's fantastic. Let's get into the technical details of HBJS. So you talked about applications running in KICS and everything else. Mm-hmm. HBJS also runs in KICS.
It does. It doesn't require any added security, any new started tasks. It's just another application that runs within a KICS region, or a best practice, multiple regions to have, to load balance and for high availability. But it's just another application that runs within CICS, taking advantage of what you already have up and running.
That's fantastic. Now, how do people work with HBJS, actually? How do the APIs get generated? How does kind of the understanding of the transactions?
It's a good one. and the answer is simple. We use VS Code. VS Code, which everyone is very familiar with already. It's the market leader for IDEs, in one place.
We talk about it a bit on this podcast, so yeah.
I may have heard it before. So I'm going to guess that our audience is very familiar
with VS Code. Indeed, yeah.
So we have an extension. We have the HBJS extension that your user can log in and it connects directly to the KICS region. And you're able to code your JavaScript and not just code it in VS Code. And you have all the benefits of linting and syntax checking, but you can actually test it and send it to the mainframe. It runs on the mainframe and presents the results. You can build it from VS Code. You can deploy it from VS Code. And since it's in VS Code, which I've said 17 times already,
VS Code,
it's already get integrated. So you can have it be part of your pipeline. So once you check that code back in, you have processes that get kicked off to throw it through all your different levels of testing.
That's more magic. I mean, it's excellent. How do customers get started with it? Or rather, right, what are they doing around KICS anyway?
Mm-hmm.
And how do they bring HBJS into the fray?
Sure. So right now, customers are doing a lot of things, right? And mainframe, it's no secret that a lot of the things that were built that are still working today were built 20 years ago, 25 years ago. Why have customers not, why has any organizations changed that? Because it's not broken.
It's not yet.
However, efficiency, things change. Are you still using the same phone you used 10 years ago, 2 years ago? So the way to get started is simple. You have whatever processes that you have now, and you can come up with one application. Let's say you're a bank and you want to integrate into an instant payment system on your phone. There is a lot of smaller regional banks or larger banks that don't have the ability to do that yet. With something like HBJS, you create an API to access that, because not only can you access everything within CICS, HBJS also has the ability to reach out. So let's say you have an API, a credit card processor in the cloud, in one of your cloud platforms. You can orchestrate a whole process and it can make those calls for you, because KICS doesn't know about the outside world.
No, exactly. That's excellent. And it's nice. You identify one kind of application, one user flow, generate the API, see the power of it, necessarily call outside, as you say, and then you can scale from there.
Yeah. And most places, most organizations will start with one or two application use cases. But then as soon as we show that and we do, we'll say a proof of concept or a proof of value, we go in and we create those use cases within days, not weeks, not months, but within days. We have working production ready APIs. Once you see how easy it is to build them, it's just JavaScript. Then you start with three, and by the end of the week, you have 10 to 12 or more.
I remember talking with Scott about this before visiting a customer, and he was insistent, adamant about the fact that can come in and generate the APIs. Really, they did just that, and it really was amazing, and the customer was just amazed, more magic out of his hat, but really that it was so easy, and they were really production ready, as mm-hmm. you say.
Yeah, it's not our proof of concepts that we do. We're doing it on a customer system, an organization system, their applications, their use cases, their needs. And when it's done, again, production ready. I would test it first, but still, it's production ready.
Oh, that's fantastic. And of course, we provide excellent support. So if anything comes up, we'll jump right back in.
Since it's all written in JavaScript, and we're all mainframers here, try teaching a JavaScript programmer mainframer COBOL, but we say we can teach any mainframer JavaScript in 3 days.
Scott, it's been an excellent overview. It's an exciting product, especially. And if you haven't considered it already, please check it out, HB.js. Try it on VS Code. They're great examples as well on the README. And otherwise, look for this guy. And he may even show you a magic trick or two.
I always have a deck of cards on me somewhere.
Scott, thank you so much.
Thanks.